Our task is to trace through the book of Revelation from the beginning to the end, highlighting key points for understanding as we progress. Now, the book was written by the Apostle John in about 96 while he was imprisoned by the Roman Empire on the Isle of Patmos. The very first verse of the first chapter says, "The revelation of Jesus Christ, which he gave unto his servants, to show unto them things which must shortly come to pass." So from the beginning, it is clear that this book is going to be a book of prophecy, about foretelling what is to happen in the future. Now, sometimes, and puzzling, the book is referred to as the Apocalypse. Now, the reason for this is that that word Apocalypse is the Greek word which is found in the Greek New Testament, which when translated means an uncovering. So the Apocalypse, the revelation, is the uncovering. And what is it to uncover? It is to uncover the work of the Lord Jesus Christ while he is in heaven. We remember he went to heaven, he was taken up into heaven, and he sits at the right hand of God. And while he sits there, this is uncovering what is happening in the times until he comes back to the earth and until the nations are prepared to accept him and for the kingdom of God to be set up. So it is called the Apocalypse or the Revelation because it is revealing God's plan. And it is called from the present and into the future. John says, "Write the things which thou hast seen, and the things which are, and the things which shall be hereafter." Here is indicated a range of time, going from John's time through into the far distant time when the Lord Jesus Christ comes back. Now, the first verse of the chapter contains another extremely important clue. "He sent and signified it by his servant John." Signifies means to show by sign and symbol. This tells us a most important fact. As I say, the book of Revelation is not like many of the other books of the Bible because it needs to be interpreted. The things which are going to be shown are signified, and therefore that's where the interpretation comes in. But the effort is going to be most worthwhile, as the third verse of the first chapter tells us. Why it's going to be worthwhile. "Blessed is he that readeth, and he that heareth the words of the prophecy, and keep them, for the time is at hand." So there is a wonderful blessing, in fact, reiterated seven times to those who will take the trouble to read the book. And it is addressed to "him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me in my throne." So from the very beginning, we find that the book is addressed for a purpose. And that is that people should be able to overcome. And we've got to ask the question, what is it that we need to develop in order to be able to overcome? And it is false teaching which is going to threaten the ecclesias and the believers. Now, the symbol or sign used some 40 times for this false teaching throughout the book is the beast. And in chapter 14, verse 10, most ominous words, it says, "If any man worship the beast and his image and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God." One of the main purposes of the book is to identify that beast and that false religion and to warn against being entrapped into this false teaching. So to those who do overcome, there's the certainty of these seven blessings interspersed throughout the book. And this first chapter has a wonderful vision of the Son of Man as he is pictured in the midst of seven lampstands. In fact, this is the first of seven such visions of the kingdom. In the 13th verse of the first chapter we read, "And in the midst of the seven candlesticks, one like unto the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to his coat, and girt about the paps with a golden girdle. And in his right hand were seven stars, and out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword." Now, this was a vision. It wasn't actually there. We see candlesticks and stars. Now, these are symbols of something else. So we can see why the book needs to be interpreted. What do these things stand for then? Well, I suggest we don't have to look far to find out, because if we read on down in that first chapter to the 20th verse, we are given the interpretation of just what these things mean. The mystery of the seven stars in my right hand and the seven golden candlesticks, the seven stars are the angels of the churches, and the seven candlesticks which thou sawest are the seven churches. So we have it interpreted for us. We are told that the candlesticks stand for or signify the churches, the ecclesias, those which the Apostle Paul had set up and left in his day. Now, so we have interpreted that, and we are told that the candlesticks stand for or signify the seven ecclesias. Now, that doesn't surprise us at all, because the purpose of an ecclesia in the whole of the scripture is to shed out the light of God's truth. So this idea of an ecclesia being portrayed by a candlestick is absolutely in line with so much else of things in the scriptures. And with a great range of other scriptural analogies. And who is the star? The star being the senior messenger, maybe the arranging brethren of the ecclesia to whom this communication is being addressed. And so I put it to you that here we have an interpretation within the very chapter giving us the meaning of the vision which the chapter itself contains. And it is an obvious interpretation being made in the light of how those terms are used in the rest of Scripture. So we can use this approach when we come to other parts of the book of Revelation. Now, other things, objects, are used as signs. For example, heaven is used as a sign. In the 6th chapter, we read that heaven departs, and in the 12th chapter, there is a birth recorded in heaven. Now, this heaven cannot be the actual place of God's abode. But we are familiar with another use of scriptural terms, because in the prophetic words, Peter says, "Nevertheless we, according to his promise, look for new heavens and a new earth wherein dwelleth righteousness." And here's a definition. The heavens are a sign for the ruling powers, whatever they may be, over the earth. The present political governments, for example, and presidents and kings, they are ruling in the heavens over the earth. And the earth itself is a symbol for the ordinary people, in other words, those who are being ruled over on the earth. At the moment, the power is under the control of men. Now, when Jesus comes back and his kingdom is set up, then those heavenly authorities, Jesus and his saints, will have control of the things on the earth, and therefore they will be, as it were, in the heavenlies. And his faithful followers, they are the ones reigning from Jerusalem. And these rulers then constitute the new heavens wherein dwells righteousness. And so we see that is how Jesus in here uses heavens as a sign. Now, the sea is also used for a sign. We are possibly familiar with the word in Isaiah where we read, "The wicked are like the troubled sea, which throweth up mire and dirt." But as an illustration, in the 15th chapter of this book of Revelation, we are told about a sea of glass. John says, "I saw, as it were, a sea of glass." Now, what could that mean? Surely it means that those nations of the world who hitherto were fomenting rebellion and warfare together and throwing up mire and dirt, as it were, that they are now at peace. And therefore the sea of glass is symbolic of the nations in God's kingdom on earth. The book also describes groups of signs, the seals, the trumpets, the vials and the thunders. These are groups of signs for God's judgments which he pours out at different times on earthly empires. We read through the book of Revelation. We come now to the second and third chapters, which is normally called the letters to the churches. And in this section, the Lord Jesus Christ gives quality assessment feedback to the ecclesias which have been established in Asia. For example, he says there are at least three things and problems that the ecclesia at Ephesus has. First of all, it has lost its first love. Its original enthusiasm that it had for the Lord has gradually waned over the years. Secondly, it has separated itself from false practices, which were very much the practices of the Nicolaitans, and this won the approval of the Lord Jesus Christ.
But thirdly, that they were tolerating wrong teaching. They had one called Jezebel in their midst, who was liable to lead them astray. So this is the sort of feedback that Jesus then gives in chapters 2 and 3 for all of those ecclesias. And overall, it ends up by showing us that Jesus is warning them all of impending times of crisis to come. And they've all got to be careful to guard that wonderful truth that he has given to them. Now, many people, in looking at the letters to the churches, see it as a totally separate section from the rest of the book of the Revelation. Now, I'm going to suggest that to do that, we're in danger of missing one of the core messages, because this message about the truth being under peril actually is a key theme of the whole of the book. And I believe this is shown in the 22nd chapter, the very last chapter, where nothing has been said about writing to the churches at all, but where Jesus says to John, "I, Jesus, have sent mine angel to tell you these things in the churches." So John's job was to tell all of the churches all of these things. Now, I think the implication of this is clear, that all the way down until the Lord Jesus Christ is to return again, there's going to be this great threat and peril of the truth being lost. And that's not new. For example, we remember the Apostle Paul in Acts chapter 20, where he says, "Of your own selves shall men arise speaking perverse things." And so here the Apostle John, through the words of the Lord Jesus Christ, is warning them. So these letters to the churches are a basic warning to ecclesias and to believers of all ages of the importance of holding on to the truth and of the great powers which are going to be against them, which will be trying to change that truth into a... And turning to the highlights of the fourth chapter, we read now of a vision of the kingdom. There are seven of these interspersed visions of the kingdom. And it says, "A throne was set in heaven and one sat on the throne." Now, here we have a picture of the kingdom of God. And we ask ourselves, well, how could you have a picture of the kingdom of God? Was it there then? The answer is no, it was a vision of the kingdom of God. Would it be there? Yes, it is going to be. It still isn't now. This is what I have called the reverse principle of the book of Revelation. In other words, it gives you the picture probably the opposite way round to what we normally would. It tells you first of all what is going to be the output, and then gives you the steps as to how it is going to be achieved. And reading into the fifth chapter, we are given a picture of the sealed scroll. And John sees in the right hand of him that sat on the throne a scroll written within and on the backside, sealed with seven seals. Now, this is where interpretation of these signs is so important, and knowing the rest of Scripture, because as soon as we read about a sealed scroll, we may very well remember about the prophet Daniel, who, in agonizing to find out what would happen, he had had to seal up the vision that he had, and he had been told that he wasn't allowed to look into it. And so we see that what actually is happening here is that the book of Revelation in the New Testament is now opening up information which Daniel wanted to see and couldn't in the Old Testament scriptures. "Go, Daniel, for the words are closed up and sealed until the time of the end," he was told. So when you undo these seals and the scroll becomes able to be seen, what does one see? Well, in the first verse of the sixth chapter, what was seen, John records, "And I saw, when the Lamb opened one of the seals, behold, a white horse." So the first thing that he saw was a white horse. Now, what could a white horse stand for? Well, reading the context here, if we just read on into the third verse, he then says, "When he opened the second seal, another horse, fiery red, went out, and it was granted to him to take peace from the earth." And therefore, within the context itself, we could well speculate that if the white horse had brought peace to the earth, then the red horse, which stands, it sounds like, for blood, takes peace away from the earth, that sounds to be the sort of scriptural symbology that we might expect. But how could we tell whether this is a right interpretation? Well, we've got to do the next test, which is to look at history. Now, there's nothing strange about this at all, because we are all familiar with the image which Nebuchadnezzar saw and the various four kingdoms which that meant. And we know full well that in order to interpret what that really means, we need to look at history and see what actually happened. So likewise here. And when we turn to the historian Gibbon, in his writings of the decline and fall of the Roman Empire, about this period that John was thinking, he says, if man were called to fix the period in the history during which the human race was most happy and prosperous, he would without hesitation name this very period. So we can see that the white horse presaged something which was then put into history. And there are another five seals which are then opened with their own representations on them. And when we look at their record in history, we can see that they also are convincingly fulfilled. When we turn to the sixth seal, we have something rather different. And I behold, when he had opened the sixth seal, and lo, it says, there was a great earthquake. And the heavens, it says, departed as a scroll. The sun and the moon and the stars fell. Now, immediately that should ring bells with us, because we're not thinking about the stars of heaven. We're thinking about those things which are symbolic. Stars symbolically, and we're talking therefore about the ruling powers that were on the earth at the time. There was going to be a tempestuous dissolution of the ruling powers and the ordered state of things as it was. Now, what actually took place? We find that in the 4th century the Emperor Constantine was converted to Christianity, and some of the Christians fought for him, having previously suffered persecution. And in so doing, they all defeated paganism, and as a long-term result, Constantine became emperor in the Roman Empire. And this produced an immense change in society, because up till now, paganism had been the dominant force in the earth. Constantine claimed that his success had come through a vision of the cross in the sky. The pagans claimed that their defeat had come about by the God of the Christians who had inflicted it upon them. And so in the 15th verse, we read this, and the kings of the earth and the great men said, fall on us and hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. And who was sitting on the throne? It was Constantine. Why were they fearful of Constantine? Because they believed that his God was stronger than their God. And the pagans, they never went away, but they were defeated at that time in that battle. And as thanks, as it were, to the Christians for having helped him in the battle, in the next year, Constantine issued what he called the Edict of Milan. And what that did was to grant to the Christians and others full authority to observe that religion which each preferred. So state religion now became Christian. Now this sounds an extremely good thing, because up till now Christians had been persecuted by the state. But it wasn't, because what became the state religion was in fact a mixture between Christianity and paganism. And in actual fact, the people who still kept truly to Christ's teachings, who for example wouldn't fight against Constantine because they knew that was wrong, they were then oppressed and they became Protestants and fled the empire. And one commentator says, Constantine's conversion had altered the city's status and landscape forever, raising the status of a once persecuted cult to that of a legitimate religion. And so we need to ask ourselves the question, well, was it really an earthquake? Is it fair to call such an event an earthquake? Because that appears to be what the book of Revelation is doing. And in the 7th chapter, we see the third vision of the kingdom, which now is going to uphold those people who have fled and are under persecution. Jesus sustains them when he says, after these things I looked and behold a great multitude which no one could number, of all nations, tribes, peoples and tongues, clothed with white robes. It was remembering that these things are going to be there for the future, and nothing that this world can do would change those things. And highlighting in the 8th chapter, we now see the opening of the seventh and last seal. And when that seal is opened, what it shows is seven trumpets. And there are seven angels which blow the seven trumpets. Now, a trumpet makes the unmistakable sound of warning and alarm. And the first four trumpet blasts signify four major attacks on the western third of the empire by the marauding tribes of barbarians. And the fourth was so intense that in actual fact, the western city of Rome was actually taken captive, and Rome fell in AD 476 as a result of these four trumpet blasts. Now, that left an interesting situation, because Constantine had moved his headquarters to Constantinople, and with the Rome having been taken over, it left, as it were, a power vacuum in the western side of the empire. And the Pope then, the head of the churches as he was growing up to be, began to be of great importance. And the Emperor Phocas in 610 decreed that the See of the Blessed Peter the Apostle, that is to say the Pope, should be the head of all the churches. And so there was a real gain in papal power. And one writer says the church was the one institution left intact, and it is now flexing its imperial muscles. And in commenting of these times in the Illustrated World History by McGraw-Hill, there's an extract which says this: in the West, as the sun set on the temporal power of Rome after 476, the papacy emerged as the heir to a new empire, Christendom. Little by little, the Roman See made itself supreme in temporal as in spiritual matters. The popes could thus consider themselves heirs to ancient Rome. And we note that only history fills in all of these details for us, which then shows how the book of Revelation is unfolding. A most important point then starts to emerge, because there were then changes in belief. From the 4th century onwards, religion in both the east and western sides of the Roman Empire started to change, in spite of the fact that the Pope was in overall control. And in 1054, what is called the Great Schism took place, which was that the Western churches disfellowshipped the churches in the Eastern section. And that division still applies today. And it represented a real loss of papal power. And highlighting then into the 9th chapter and the 5th trumpet, we've seen the 4 trumpets which caused the downfall of Rome. In the 5th trumpet, then I saw the 5th angel sounded, and I saw a star fallen from heaven to the earth. To him was given the key to the bottomless pit. Now, we are familiar with stars and important personages in the heavens of the rule over the kingdoms of men. And if we look into the 7th century, we can see that there was a most important development which took place, namely, in the appearance on the scene of the Prophet Muhammad. Now, there are some very important things which are described about this personage. You see, the Bible says he was in heaven, he was fallen to the earth, and to him was given the key to the bottomless pit. Now, what is being spoken about here? Well, we are familiar with heaven being an elevated position and the earth down from that. And when we look at the history of the Prophet Muhammad, we find that he was originally, in the beginning of the 7th century, with the Quraysh tribe, who had charge of the black stone, which was supposed to have come down from heaven to earth. And people paid a lot of money to go and visit it and do their holy obeisances. It's just like today, all the Muslims go to Mecca, and everyone did then. And a great amount of money was made for this tribe by these people visiting. But Muhammad started having ideas that he was a prophet sent from God. And when the leader of the clan died in 622, they thought he was too much of a threat to them, and so they threw him out, and he had to flee. The fleeing of the Prophet Muhammad from Mecca to earth, as it were. And therefore, that's the first clue that we have. But not only so, he still went on with his desires to write out these things which he thought God was saying to him. And so he began to write out the Quran, which was greatly against those who believed in a Trinitarian God and in favor of those who believed in the unity God. And with his sayings and his writings, he gathered a large number of people round him, numerous. In fact, the history book tells us that there were 130,000 gathered round him. The Arabs had never seen an army like it. That's what he had the key to, the bottomless pit of all these people. And what did he do with them? Well, he started off and led them towards the eastern part of the Roman Empire. And although he died in the meanwhile, by the end of this period, the Eastern Roman Empire had been vanquished. The sixth trumpet, in the 14th verse of the 9th chapter, was blown by the sixth angel. And the saying was at that time, loose the four angels which are bound in the great river Euphrates. Now, the Euphrates rises in Turkey. And when we look in history, we see that there were four great attacks by the Turkish people on Constantinople, on the eastern end of the empire, and Constantinople fell in 1453. So by 1453, both Rome in the west had fallen and Constantinople in the east had fallen. Now, why was this? Well, the scriptures are not short in telling us why. Revelation 9 says, and the rest of the men which were not killed by these plagues, yet repented not of the works of their hands. They were speaking against the God of heaven, and so God was removing their kingdom. And in the 10th chapter, we can highlight the apostle when he sees another mighty angel who swore that there should be delay no longer. But very momentous words, he says, in the days of the sounding of the seventh trumpet, the mystery of God would be finished. Now that's an advance warning. This is the sixth trumpet that's been sounded. We've got to watch out for the seventh trumpet. But before that happens, the 11th chapter gives us a wonderful piece of history on the two witnesses. Verse 3. And I will give power unto my two witnesses, and they shall prophesy 1,260 days clothed in sackcloth. Now, the first thing to notice is that period of time, 1,260 days, just as there are signs in how things are described visually in the book of Revelation, so there's sign times, and often the day for a year principle applies. So 1,260 days is going to work out to be 1,260 years. And the two witnesses represent two classes of people standing up against the curtailment of liberty which the Roman Empire is bringing upon them. And we remember in AD 312, when the edict was issued, how that the true witnesses immediately became under pressure. And that pressure went on, in fact, for a period of 1,260 years. And the book of Revelation in the 7th chapter tells how that witnessing of these people would be completed. It says, the beast that ascendeth out of the bottomless pit shall make war against them and kill them. Now, what happened and who was and what was this beast? How were the witnesses put down? Well, we have amazingly in history an eyewitness account of when, on a certain day called St. Bartholomew's Day, which is still exemplified and remembered now, St. Bartholomew's Day, the 24th of August, 1572, there was a great killing of something like 30,000 Protestants. And there's on record the following. It says, the court spiritual advisor, a Jesuit priest, urged them to massacre the Protestants, beginning at Paris, the French soldiers and the Roman Catholic clergy fell upon the unarmed people, and blood flowed like a river throughout the entire country. And there we see the identification of those who had led to the war and put down those Protestants. The spiritual advisor, a Jesuit priest, and the rest of the Roman Catholic clergy had brought this about. So the beast that ascendeth out of the bottomless pit shall make war against them turned out to be no less and none other than the French soldiers and the Roman Catholic clergy.
And the 1260 days, or 1260 years, starting from the beginning of the Protestants in AD 312, leads you to the year AD 1572, 1572, which indeed was the date of this anniversary. And so we have a positive identification of the beast with the Roman Catholic system and of 1260 days in Book of Revelation here, standing for 1260 years. The 11th chapter tells us that there was a great earthquake and a tenth part of the city fell. And what this is showing is that there was seething discontent arrived in France as a result of the oppression of the Roman Catholic forces. And in 1789, it all boiled over and there was the French Revolution. And the Larousse Encyclopedia, commenting on this, describes it as being a great revolution, a great earthquake, that has afflicted and affected all generations down since. Because the three things that came out of that French Revolution were liberty, equality, and fraternity. And those drivers of personal humanism are what has sparked off and caused the revolutions since that day, causing and leaving us with the world in its present state and with all the revolutions which stand. The human spirit was enabled to come through and to have its way. Just as a forward view, when in a moment when we look into the 16th chapter, we shall see that these three forces are described as frog-like spirits which come out and which mould the ages which appear afterwards. And so these things are very apposite to the world in which we live today. In actual fact, of course, we know them today as socialism, democracy, and humanism. And these are the forces as Larousse Encyclopedia describes them. And in the 15th verse of this 11th chapter, we now come across those words of which we have been warned. And the seventh angel sounded. What did we have to watch out for? That then would be the conclusion of the mystery. And there were great voices in heaven, the record says, saying, the kingdoms of this world are become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign for ever and ever. So there's the seventh angel. There is the return of Christ. Has he actually returned? No. Has he returned by now? No. In vision and in symbol, as far as the book of Revelation was concerned, he had returned. Verse 18, the nations were angry, thy wrath is come, and the time of the dead, that they should be judged, and thou give reward unto thy people. Christ must have returned symbolically by the end of Revelation chapter 11. So we see that in fact the book of Revelation is in at least two parts. We've got chapters 1 to 11, which deals with the history from Jesus going into heaven to when he comes again. Now part 2 is also going to deal with that same period of time, but what it's going to do now, it's going to pick up those ideas that we've seen about error entering into the church and about the beast oppressing the believers, and chapters 12 to 19 are going to tell us far more about that as we find it. We need now to highlight the reason why the whole of the second part of the book of Revelation is devoted to the development of error within the church. And the answer is given to us, really, in the 14th chapter and the 9th verse, where the scripture says, if any man worship the beast and his image, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God. So the beast system which is going to arise is hated by God. And it is the development of that that God is showing to his servants to beware of those things. That's why it is so important and so much time devoted to it. Now, the beast system has its roots in the book of Daniel. Now, we're all familiar with Nebuchadnezzar's image and also with the four beasts that Daniel saw in his dream. And the fourth beast and the legs of the image are both symbolic of iron and the iron of Rome. And the fourth beast, which Daniel saw, had 10 horns. And so there's an immediate linkage with the book of Daniel and with the book of the Revelation, which also speaks, as we see, about a beast with 10 horns. So a comparison of Nebuchadnezzar's dream with that of Daniel clearly indicates the fourth beast with 10 horns stands for Rome. And this beast with 10 horns is described at various stages of its life in the book of Revelation. And a comparison of Daniel chapter 7 with Revelation 17 and 19 give us these common factors about these beasts. Both of them have 10 horns. They both endure throughout history and are slain at the judgment. Both of them use words of blaspheming against God, and both are in the end annihilated by being burned in the flaming fire. And so we feel there's strong grounds for saying that the beasts of Revelation reveal the future development of Daniel's fourth beast. And the scriptures, in fact, identify in general the development of opposition to true Christians throughout the ages, which is what these beasts are going to stand for, that they would seek to persecute and eliminate true believers, that these errors would become fully mature at Christ's return and would actively oppose him and finally be destroyed by him. Now let's just have a look at some of this error coming into true belief, which is within the whole scripture. In the 7th chapter of Daniel, about the beasts, he says, "I considered the horns, and among them came up a little horn which had eyes like the eyes of a man, and a mouth speaking great things." So error was to arise out of the Roman Empire, future to Daniel's time. And in the 7th chapter, Daniel says, "The Ancient of Days did sit, the judgment was set, and they behold the voice of the great words which the horn spake. His body was destroyed and given to the burning flame." And so Daniel gives us a picture of this great force being present in his day and going right the way through to the time of the return of Jesus Christ. In other words, it is a force of error which is going to pervade the whole of history. Now, the Apostle Paul warns of error in his second letter to Thessalonians. He says, "For that day shall not come except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed." And again, in his letter to Timothy, he says, "Now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter times men shall depart from the faith, giving heed to spirits and doctrines of devils." And most significantly, he says, "Men would arise forbidding to marry and commanding to abstain from meats." And we might well ponder as to any errors which might have those features associated with them. And in the second letter to the Thessalonians, Paul says, "For the mystery of iniquity doth already work. Until he be taken out of the way, then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the brightness of his coming." So the Apostle Paul, like Daniel, sees a great error pervading the whole of history and being there until it is finally consumed by the coming of Jesus Christ. Error was already creeping into the truth in the time of Paul. Now that's very important. It would expand from Paul's time and would only be destroyed at the return of Jesus. Now the Apostle John himself also most specifically warns of error. He says, "For many deceivers are entered into the world, who confess not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh. This is a deceiver and an antichrist." Now John very clearly gives us a measuring rod, as it were, for those who are deceiving. They say that Christ has not come in the flesh, not the same flesh as human beings have. And of course, we know the doctrines followed by the Roman Church line up with that. The telltale identification of Antichrist is that Christ has not come in the flesh. It's something different. So that spirit of error had already developed in the ecclesias. False prophets had left the truth, John says. Seducing spirits, doctrines of devils, and a spirit of Antichrist would arise. All of these outside of the book of Revelation, and now the book of Revelation is giving us, as it were, a sequence scale on which these things are going to take place. In Revelation chapter 2 and the 20th verse in his letter to the churches, he says, "Thou sufferest that woman Jezebel, which calleth herself a prophetess, to teach and to seduce servants." So false prophets were already in the ecclesia, teaching doctrines of paganism. Now, as we commented previously, when paganism was destroyed, it wasn't done away with, and it did find its way into the teaching of the Roman Catholic Church. In further describing the error that was coming into the situation, the 16th chapter, John sees three unclean spirits which bring forth error out of the dragon, the beast, and the false prophet, for they are spirits of devils working miracles. And that false prophet, we need to just highlight a point about that, because many people say the false prophet stands for the Muslims. But now we've done this investigation, we can see that that cannot be the case, because the error which is going to grow up in the church has been there from the time of the apostles and the letters to the churches. The Muslims only emerged 622 years after this error had started to work. So it was there far before that, and is encompassed, as we have seen, in the spirit of the Church of Rome. So we can recognize that the Apocalypse 12 onwards symbolically presents the beast system with its various alias signs. Alias the false prophet, alias the spirit of Antichrist, alias the man of sin, all of which develops in opposition to Christ and will be in confrontation with him at the Battle of Armageddon at his return. And then the beast system will finally be consumed, destroyed, and burnt up as portrayed in the scripture. So chapter 12 of the Revelation links back to the defeat of paganism, and it symbolically links to the rise of the empire of Constantine in AD 312. Chapter 12, verse 1, gives us a picture of the woman clothed with the sun and with the moon at her feet. The woman clothed with the sun is a picture of the true chaste ecclesia, which had become corrupted with political power. Now, when had this occurred? It occurred after AD 312, when Constantine defeated paganism with the help, the political help, of the church. And verse 2 describes this as the original chaste virgin being with child. Chapter 17 again refers to this apostate church as the great whore that sitteth upon many waters. Chapter 13, verse 11, introduces important developments which are not seen in chapters 1 to 11. The beast now shown has two horns like a lamb. Now, history shows that in AD 800, the Holy Roman Empire emerged and endured until quite recent times, until 1806. It was uniquely characterized by a dual leadership of both the Pope on the one hand and the Emperor on the other. So the Pope at last had achieved the ascendancy in his political power that he'd been working for. And as Michael Bryce, the historian, says, the head is the Pope to whom souls are entrusted, and the Emperor is commissioned to rule men's bodies. And it turned out to be a most repressive regime. It instituted the horrors of the Inquisition and was a terrible situation in the world for nearly 1,000 years. Chapter 14 introduces the fifth of these interspersed visions of the kingdom, and it says, "And I looked, and lo, a lamb stood on the Mount Zion, and with him 144,000, having his father's name written in their foreheads, and they sung, as it were, a new song before the throne." Now, these visions were to have a function in sustaining the saints living all down through the ages. And here we're particularly struck with the wonderful contrast which is revealed. The true lamb, holy, harmless, and undefiled, is seen in sharp contrast to the horrific two-horned lamb, which was, in essence, a wolf dressed up in sheep's clothing. A wonderful consolation for the saints who were facing the rigors of that terrible Inquisition in that time. And a wonderful reminder to all subsequently that the certainty of that final revelation is yet to be,
and that God will gather together that representative 144,000 to enjoy the glories of all these things which he has revealed. Turning to the 15th chapter of the book of Revelation, we come in effect to another end point in the return of Jesus himself, where the apostle recalls, "And I saw, as it were, a sea of glass mingled with fire. A vision for the saints of all ages to encourage them to overcome." The sea of glass is to replace the turmoil of the nations which now fling up mire and dirt and cause agonies of sorrow and cry. And the sounds of joy and singing are yet to be heard as they sing the song of Moses and the Lamb. "And I heard a voice from heaven saying, Write, blessed are the dead which die in the Lord from henceforth." Now, after enduring for over 1,000 years, the Holy Roman Empire came to an end. And we might ask, what brought it to an end? And the answer is given to us in the 16th chapter of the book of Revelation and the 10th verse, where we read, "And the fifth angel poured out his vial upon the seat," or the throne, "of the beast, and his kingdom was full of darkness." The vile judgments of God, you remember we had the seals, trumpets, and vials. The vile judgments of God were poured out to end the horrific goings on under this Holy Roman Empire. And the fact that the seat of the beast was brought to darkness, what actually happened was that the Pope, Pope Pius, was put in prison by Napoleon and only released subsequently in 1814. And the Papal States were taken and annexed in 1870. So that is how the Holy Roman Empire came to an end. And the Pope, after his release, reinstated the Inquisition, brought back the Jesuits, and became the first modern pope to expressly condemn and fight against modern developments in politics, religion, and philosophy. And we are familiar with all the way in which the popes, in their various ways, have made their presence felt on the world stage. So that's the first five vials of God's wrath. The 16th chapter and the 12th verse, we can highlight the sixth angel who poured out his vial upon the great river Euphrates, and the water thereof was dried up, that the way of the kings of the east might be prepared. The river Euphrates dried up? Remember, we're in sign language. And in fact, the river Euphrates stands for the country through which it mostly flows, which is Turkey, and from which the majority of its waters come. Did Turkey dry up? This is a most remarkable prophecy, because we have here a map of Turkey as it was in 1300. And by 1880, it had taken over a great deal of territory in the Middle East and also in North Africa. But by 1910, a great deal of that territory had been lost. And by 1920, the original territory was about the same as it started off with. It was like a tide coming in and then flowing out again. And really, the fulfillment of the prophecy about Turkey is one of the most spectacular in the Bible. But what was its purpose? Britain's Balfour Declaration in 1917 is associated with this, because that's when the Turkish power over the Holy Land was finally brought to an end. And Israel were free then to return and to start returning to their own land. So that, as the scripture says, the way of the kings of the east might be prepared. That is to say, did Israel back in their land, they're getting prepared for their king to come. And once he comes and re-establishes the kingdom, then the kings, the rulers, and the immortal ones from that will be free to go out into all the world and to bring the kingdom into other parts of the world. And then a gathering of the nations continues to follow in this 16th chapter of the book of Revelation. And John says, "I saw three unclean spirits like frogs, for they are the spirits of devils, which go forth to the kings of the earth. And what is their purpose? To gather them
together to that battle of the great day of God Almighty. Now these spirits which gather the nations, we've already seen where they come from. They came from the French Revolution, liberty, equality and fraternity, which in these latter days became more commonly known as socialism, humanism and democracy. Those are the very things. So when we look at the world and hear the news and see all the gatherings together of the nations and the things which are happening, we can be quite sure that the Holy Spirit of God and His plan is working through all of these things to bring the nations finally to the point where Jesus will be able to return. And in the midst of the nations gathering together, Jesus comes to take His people to judgment. Behold, I come as a thief. Blessed is he that watcheth and keepeth his garments, lest he walk naked and they see his shame. And so this re-emergence of Jesus comes in the middle of all of these things happening in the nations. So we can see that the times in which we live could well presage that very thing. And is everybody to see Jesus come? The answer is no, as a thief-like coming. Who will know about it? Scripture tells us that in that day one shall be taken and the other left. Jesus is coming to take his chosen ones to judgment, and then he will prepare them, and the next time they will be seen is with him and overcoming the nations in the battle of Armageddon. So it shows us that we're right in the end of the days. And that gathering process, according to verse 16, is to continue. He gathered them together into a place called in the Hebrew tongue Armageddon. And we think that that Hebrew tongue gives us the indication as to where that gathering is to be. It's to be into the land of Israel. Because by this time, Israel, having been at peace, will become invaded by the northern host. And Jesus and the saints will interfere and intervene in order to save Israel at the time of their need. The great battle with the nations against him will be fought by Jesus and his people in the land of Israel. And we are now in the realms of the Old Testament prophets. Ezekiel chapter 38, God says, I will call for a sword against him, that is Gog. Throughout all my mountains, saith the Lord, every man's sword shall be against his brother. Yea, all the people of the land shall bury them, and that will be the end of the great Gogian invasion. And in the next chapter in Ezekiel, we see about the blessing of Israel. Therefore, thus saith the Lord God, now will I bring again the captivity of Jacob and have mercy upon the whole house of Israel, after that they have borne their shame and all their trespasses whereby they have trespassed against me, when they dwelt safely in their land and none made them afraid. And so in the sequence of the development of these things, we see it is going to be essential for the children of Israel to dwell in their land safely at a time, not when Jesus is with them, but at a time when they're free to do their own thing and they commit their own trespasses against God. And they dwell safely in the land for a period of time. And that dwelling safely presages the Gogian host to come into the land, which then fires off the beginning of those great battles of the day of Armageddon. And with these things, we are coming very close to the end of the vision which John started off with, where he would finally see the things to do with Jesus and his saints being brought together in glory. And he saith unto me, write, blessed are they which are called unto the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he saith unto me, these are the true sayings of God. And we're getting into this time. It hasn't happened yet. It's still to happen in the future. A blessing associated with those who will strive to be with the Lord. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people. And God himself shall be with them and be their God. Rulership from Jerusalem by Jesus and the immortal saints with saved people who will worship him will allow at the end of the 1,000 years God to dwell with men. And the seventh blessing comes in the last chapter of the book, and behold, I come quickly, and my reward is give me to give every man according as his work shall be. Blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city. And so the call is to overcome, as it was in the very third chapter of this book.
And it is overcome and shown by working, doing things which Jesus would have done, and by bringing forth fruit to his name. And so we have got towards the end of the book, and now we can just do a summary of the main events and perhaps fill in one or two gaps that we've been unable to in our highlighting. Chapter 1, the opening vision. And then chapters 2 and 3, the letters to the ecclesias, forewarning them and all ecclesias down through the century of the likelihood of error coming in and of the need to keep away from compromise with the world. And the fourth chapter, the vision of the future kingdom of God on earth. The fifth and sixth chapters telling us of the seal judgments as the seal is undone, those things which Daniel wished to look into, for portraying the fall of pagan Rome. And then chapters 9 to 11, the trumpet judgments, the fall of the Eastern and Western empires. And then into chapter 16, the vile judgments and the fall of that terribly oppressive Holy Roman Empire. And then the thunder judgments and the fall of Babylon the Great under all the terrible things of the conflict between Jesus and the saints and the nations of the world who will raise themselves up against him at the Battle of Armageddon. And then at the end of it all, that sea as a sea of glass, the marriage of the Lamb and the fall of the nations, chapter 19. Chapter 20, the millennium, the 1,000 years reign during which the kings of the East go out into the world to bring the righteousness of Jesus to those in the world who will listen to them and will be involved for 1,000 years. And at the end, those who have been faithful, they also will be taken into the kingdom. And so at the very last, we see a picture of New Jerusalem and the final message which comes. And that is the thing that we are looking forward to and the immediate thing for the future. Now, we have to be prepared. We are to expect Christ to silently take the saints for judgment and preparation any time from now. Now, in the foregoing highlights, lack of time has forbidden the filling in of much detail about events we can expect to see in the future. We need to proceed cautiously, though, in order to avoid dogmatism and no predicting of dates, because we can't do that. But some trends already discernible are very likely to be followed through. And so, examples of what we could be looking out for unless we are taken first. The Pope's role in both EU and with the Orthodox Christians we would expect to accelerate. The Roman Catholic Church itself to become strengthened, with the daughter churches being associated once again, like, for example, the Anglicans. Russia to become more involved with the EU at its centre. A growing expectation of Antichrist to arise and to be seen in the earth. And finally, Israel to become truly at rest, an easy target for the Gogian invasion. Now, the object of this presentation then has been to attempt to attribute to the book of Revelation the value which it deserves as being the only communication to his servants from the risen Lord in heaven. We do hope that the highlights considered will be sufficient to enthuse all who see this presentation to investigate the apocalypse for themselves, realizing that the time is short. And in the 21st chapter, in the first verse, in conclusion, John says, "And I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea." And now, with our wonderful understanding we've gained in just a few minutes, we can see exactly what is being said. The new heaven with Christ and his saints in control. The new earth, people in the earth now who want to learn from Jesus and to want to go up to Jerusalem year by year to worship him. And the first heaven and the first earth, of all the fighting and all the problems, sin and pain and death having passed away, no more sea of the nations boiling up mire and dirt, but just a sea of glass, and glory to God, and the glory of God covering the waters as it covers the sea.